Hi everybody, this is Dr. Ang. I'm bringing you a video on venipuncture complications. So we're going to talk about all the things that can happen before the collection in this video. So let's talk a little bit about pre-analytic variables. So there are many variables that can occur before the collection that can interfere with the collection process or affect the quality of the results obtained. So there are variables that are related to the patient's condition and preparation that you may not be able to modify in any kind of way. So age, sex, alcohol consumption, medications the patients are on, altitude at which the blood is drawn or at which you live, dehydration, their posture, whether they're sitting down, laying down, can they, if they're laying down, can even sit up. Diurnal variations, exercise, fasting, pregnancy, obesity, all of those things. So there are some factors that can prevent access to the patient. One of them is locating the patient. So this will be for inpatients. So if you go to locate a patient in the room that they're supposed to be in, they're not there. It could be that they're somewhere for therapy, that maybe they were taken down for imaging or for a procedure of some sort, and they could have also have moved a patient from one room to another. So sometimes you have to kind of chase them down. If it's something that is a stat or short turnaround time, you may have to go find them down in the procedure room, cath lab, imaging. If it's something that's routine and can wait, then you can communicate with the nursing staff and come back later. Then you're going to have some barriers in identifying the patient. So, especially if somebody is unconscious, they cannot talk to you. So then you have to rely on the armbands, and the armband needs to be affixed to the patient, not to the bed rail, or not just laying on a table there near the patient. There are also some other things that you need to consider that you may run into. So, for example, modified names. So often what happens is in the requisitions and in all the medical records, you have the legal name of the patient. So a common one, for example, would be William as a first name, but they go by Bill or something like that, right? So that would be, this is what I mean by a modified name. And so when you ask them, can you tell me your name and date of birth? They may answer you by Bill such and such instead of William. And so you can ask them to clarify if their legal name is William or whatever. And if they prefer to go by Bill and they're okay with you, calling them by that, then for the rest of the conversation, you're welcome to call them by what they go by, but you do need to make sure that you have identified them by their legal name. Same thing if they go by their middle name. So they may spurt out whatever they go by, and that might be their middle name. And you may or may not have their full middle name in your requisition. So you may have an initial, if it's R, for example, it's a female, let's say it's Emily R. something Smith, whatever. Well, maybe they go by R and R is Rachel. Maybe they go by Rachel. So, and it's okay for you to call them by that. It's just like, again, you might have to dig a little bit to make sure you have the right patient and the right information, especially if the date of birth matches. And then sometimes you have transgender people, and they may choose to go by a name that's different than their legal name. And so, again, just, tactfully approach that. They do need to identify themselves by their legal name, but if they prefer to go by a different name, then you can call them that. You just have to first identify them by what matches the requisition. So, anyway, so just be very careful, because that is a place where if a patient is not correctly identified, it can lead to disastrous consequences from anywhere from, wrong type of blood giving, and it could kill a patient, to treatment based on results that aren't theirs. So it is very important to correctly identify the patient. So you can have a sleeping or unconscious patient. So always wake sleeping patients gently. Don't scare them, and make sure that they are oriented and they know what's going on before you start the procedure, and that they can answer your questions and that they're pretty clear headed. If you run into an unconscious patient, especially in the ICU, and they're not wakeable basically because of the medications that they're on, I would say talk to them just like if they are conscious. So just tell them what you're going to do, just like you would if the patient was conscious. So sometimes you walk in a room, there may be a physician or clergy there. So you can come back later if it's a routine draw, unless it is a stat or a time draw. And if it's a stat draw and a physician's in there, he probably is going to be expecting you. If it is a time draw, you can, you know, you can talk to him and say, okay, I've got a time draw for this or that. He may tell you, I need 5 more minutes or whatever. Then you, you know, if you can wait outside of the room for the, you know, allow the time, you know, allow them to finish and be out of there. And you know, the clergy, they, you know, they may stay, they may step out. Just take your cues from the physician for sure as to whether to leave or stay. And, you know, just always be respectful. Then it can be visitors there in the room. So you want to greet everyone and explain why you are there without divulging too much information, especially protected information, because the patient may not want to, all their friends that are here to know everything that's going on with them. So just definitely respect a patient's privacy. It is okay to just say, hey, I'm here to draw some blood, and you can just leave it at that. And that is just enough information without divulging too much. So most visitors will tend to leave while you work. Family members sometimes may stay, and some may even write down everything that you do, especially if they've had some issues with healthcare workers or with situations that have gone bad for their family member, then they may be documenting absolutely everything that happens at every minute of the day. Apprehensive patients. So these are patients that are fearful for getting stuck. Just do your best to calm them and engage them. There can be also some language issues. So most hospitals have a translator or translation services that are available. But you can get quite a bit done using nonverbal communication. So you could show them, you know, the tubes that you need to fill with blood. You can show them your, you know, needle assembly syringe or something like that, just to indicate, hey, I need to get some blood. And you can show, you can just sign your, you know, show your arm and say, hey, I need to get some blood from here for a test. And then they'll probably understand and let you do it. If the patient refuses, you need to communicate with a nurse and definitely document patient refusal. The nurse may decide to come in, intervene, and talk to the patient and hopefully talk them into it. But if the patient's still adamant that it's a refusal, you cannot force them. And so, but you need to document that you, you know, the steps that you've taken and who you've communicated with. So you can have some site selection issues. So occluded and sclerosed veins. So veins that are occluded, which are blocked, or sclerosed, which are hardened, will feel hard or cord-like and lack resiliency. They won't be bouncy and kind of soft like good healthy veins are. So this can be caused by inflammation, disease, chemotherapy, prolonged IV therapy, or repeated venipunctures. Such veins are going to be susceptible to infections. And because the blood flow is impaired, the sample may produce erroneous test results. So if you can, look for alternate sites. Those can be difficult to come by also. Hematomas, they may be caused by the needle going through the vein, or having the bevel opening only partially in the vein, or by failing to apply enough pressure after withdrawal of the needle. So blood from a hematoma is no longer fresh from the vein, and hematoma can obstruct the vein, which then can slow blood flow. So ideally, you should not stick in a hematoma or a bruised area, you know, because it, you know, it can cause problems and get a bad sample. And then you also have edema. So the arm could appear swollen because of the accumulation of tissue fluid. So this is a good representation here of edema. Sometimes there can be so bad that when you tie the tourniquet around the arm starts weeping tissue fluid. The tourniquet gets soaked in tissue fluid. And you just need to do your best, but you just have to know that when you first hit it, you'll go through, you may have some tissue fluid in there that can cause a sample to clot. If you're using a butterfly needle, it can actually pull tissue fluid into the tubing. It's not a bad idea to draw a discard tube first and then get your, you know, regular tubes. But, you know, that could be a problem with site selection. And then, of course, burn scars and tattoos. So areas with burn scars or tattoos could have impaired circulation. They are susceptible to infection and may be painful or difficult to penetrate. Any open or weeping lesions, skin rashes, recent tattoos, or incompletely healed stitches are examples of sites that should be avoided because of their increased risk of infection. So next we have mastectomies. So the removal of the lymph tissue on the side of a mastectomy can cause lymphostasis. So it's a lack of lymph fluid movement. And so that can cause a swelling in that arm if any procedure is done on the arm that's on the side of a mastectomy. So that collection could also be painful to the patient and the risk of infection is increased. So the rule of thumb is you cannot draw or do any kind of procedures on a side that a mastectomy is on, which then if they're hospitalized, it can be challenging because then that means that you only have a single arm that you can work on and that arm may already have an IV in there. And so we're going to talk about working with IV sites here in just a second. And if they've had a double mastectomy, then you need to clear with a physician like where you need to draw blood or if you can have approval for using their arm if they've had a double mastectomy. So IV sites, blood should not be drawn from an arm if there's an IV device in place. You want to use the other arm instead or use an alternative site. And the alternative site could be a hand. There are instances, though, where you can stop the IV if the nurse is okay with that and draw in the arm that has an IV. So we're going to talk about that for a second here in a little bit. So if you have difficulties finding a vein, always check the other arm first and check alternate locations like the back of the hand. You can enhance vein prominence by massaging gently upward from the wrist to the elbow. You can dangle the arm in a downward position so to increase blood flow in the arm and keep the arm below the heart. You can apply heat. Heated blankets can be really good there to put around an arm to increase the circulation. And you can rotate the wrist to increase the prominence of the cephalic vein, which is the one that's kind of on the medial surface of the arm. You can use a blood pressure cuff, which is a sphygmomanometer. You can place it 3 to 4 inches above the venipuncture site and inflate it to a pressure that is above diastolic but below systolic. And you can use, of course, alternative sites like the back of the hand with a butterfly needle or winged infusion set. So you have to have a physician approval to stick a foot or a leg, but those are also possible alternatives. You just always want to check and ask because if somebody is got type 2 diabetes and already has circulation issues, sticking in the foot or the leg could cause infection and really all kinds of problems because there's really slow healers on their legs and feet. You can clean the site. So for blood alcohol testing, you cannot use alcohol, so you have to use povidone iodine instead. If you leave the tourniquet on too long, so that would be longer than a minute, you can get hemoconcentration, and you can get the development of petechiae, which is what I try to represent here. And with this picture, they're little beady pinpoint bruises. That's what petechiae are. So you do not want to put the tourniquet on too tightly, but it does need to be tight enough to reveal the veins. And then you need to be aware that some people may have latex allergy, although most of the tourniquets are non-latex anymore. It's just good to be aware of that. In the hand collection, using a winged infusion set, a butterfly, you just need to be very careful. Though it is a good alternate site, but you want to make sure that you don't blow the hand vein, that those veins can be fragile, they can roll around more, and you also have a greater risk of injury with a dirty needle if you use a butterfly needle. So, all right, that wraps up this. We are going to talk a little bit more about this collection issues and venipuncture complications during collection here in just a minute.